You know, there's several professions that don't get enough credit, but I think one of the unsung heroes in our culture are people who are men and women who are EMTs, emergency medical technicians. And I don't know if you've ever been in a situation where you had to call 911 and, you know, a couple of folks show up, two or three folks show up, you've never met them before, and they just go to work. And the amazing thing to me about EMTs is they don't know what they're walking into, but they know it's an emergency, and they walk in and they're asking people questions and they're getting different answers and they're getting information and misinformation, and then they just figure out what they need to do and they just go to work. And they do it. And one of the things they never do is try to assess the guilt or the fault of the person who's been injured. They just go to work and they save the day. We're in the middle of a series where we're following Jesus from the moment he stepped onto the pages of history as an adult on the banks of the Jordan River to the moment in time that he served as the Savior of all mankind. And we've said throughout this series, and this is the thing that we hope you take to the very end with us, is that Jesus did not come to continue something that had begun a long time ago. Jesus didn't come as Judaism 2.0. He didn't come to complete the Bible. Jesus came to introduce something detached from everything that came before that was absolutely standalone, brand new. That he came to establish a brand new relationship between God and man, a brand new covenant. He came to give us an overarching ethic for all of our relational decisions, our financial decisions, that he refers to as his new command. And he came to begin a brand new movement that we call the church. And when he showed up, he immediately drawed a crowd, and when he showed up, he immediately disturbed the status quo, because whereas most of the people who followed Jesus thought he was the continuation of something old, that perhaps he was just a new rabbi with a new spin on Torah, that he'd come to maybe bring some reform to the temple system and to the religious system of his day. There was a group that understood from day one that this is a troublemaker, this is someone who's come to disrupt, this is someone who's introducing not an add-on, not a continuation of something that's absolutely brand new. And it was the men who controlled the temple. It was the men who controlled the religious system in first century Galilee and specifically Judea. The men who controlled what happened for people who came to the temple and left the temple. And what they understood in Jesus was something that was absolutely true that most people missed. That this was something that was a total departure from everything that came before. In fact, when Jesus was eventually arrested and they tried to bring witnesses in against him, one of the things they accused him of was inciting rebellion with the people. Because they saw something most people didn't see, and they saw something that many church people don't see as well. One day, Jesus and his guys were, in fact, we left off here last time, Jesus and his guys were walking through a wheat field, and as the disciples start breaking off heads of grain to eat them because they're hungry, but it's the Sabbath, and the Pharisees and the posse that always followed Jesus to try to catch him doing something wrong said, aha, you're doing it again, you're violating the Sabbath, and they get into this argument, and finally at the end, Jesus leans in, and we talked about this, and he said, look, you're so concerned about the law, me too, I'm a Jewish man. You're so concerned about the temple, me too, I'm a Jewish man. You're so concerned about all of these things, but don't you recognize something new has come? Then he leans in and he says something so offensive. We read right by it. He says, look at me. Something greater than the temple is here. But if something was greater than the temple, then the temple was no longer necessary because the temple was the epicenter of Jewish life. The temple is where they housed the Torah, the law. The temple is where God in some way resided and represented the people and protected the people. And Jesus makes a statement that makes no sense. Something greater than the temple is here. And he would predict in that moment something extraordinary, that sacred. Sacred was always a space in the first century. Sacred was a place. Sacred was priests. Sacred was a text. Sacred was sacred men in sacred places doing sacred things. And Jesus was announcing, and it would begin to unroll. He was letting the world know that soon sacred would be commuted. That it would be commuted to the hearts and the minds and the consciences of people. That there would be no more sacred spaces and no more sacred places because there would be nothing more sacred than the person you're seated next to, the person you work with, the children that you're raising, the person you've committed your life to. Because the Spirit of God was going to leave the temple. The mobile God was about to inhabit the hearts and the lives of people. And when that happened, everything would change. And as a foreshadowing, he would spend time with untouchable people, and he would touch untouchable people, and he would invite a tax gatherer to be one of his followers, and then he would go to that tax collector's homes. And even Jesus' closest disciples weren't so sure they wanted to do that. That was like a bridge too far. Tax gatherers are traitors to their nation. They're an embarrassment to their family. And Jesus says to Matthew, I want you to follow me. To which Peter said, if he follows us, I might unfollow because he's not my people. And Jesus said, that's my point. Sacred is about to be commuted. Now, this disturbing of this peace and this disruption of the status quo was certainly threatening to some. But as we're going to discover today, it was actually intriguing to some others. Most assumed that Jesus' endgame was that he would march into Jerusalem, probably around Passover, because there was always unrest in Jerusalem around Passover. Everybody was on edge, the nerves were high, and people were always hoping that this would be the Passover, that God would do something spectacular and send Messiah. And everybody assumed that at some point, maybe on a Passover, Jesus enters Jerusalem. And he takes off his rabbinic robe, and they discover he has a big M on the shirt underneath, Messiah. And he proclaims himself king. And they reestablish the nation of Israel as a kingdom. And Rome is thrown outside the borders. And things would be restored to the time of like Solomon or David. But the more discerning who listened to Jesus, they sensed that perhaps something else was up with him. Because he spoke, as we've seen, he spoke with extraordinary authority, but he refused to take charge. He almost immediately, he won the crowd, but he refused the crown. He had extraordinary power and influence, but over and over and over, he refused to leverage that power and that influence for his own sake. He was intriguing, for sure. Now, there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council, and the Jewish ruling council was also called the Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin was like the parliament and the Supreme Court all rolled into one. And Nicodemus, who was a Pharisee, that meant he started at the lowest rung of the ladder in terms of religious status, and because he was politically astute, perhaps, because he was well-connected, perhaps, we don't know, he had worked his way into this very elite group of men that served like, again, the Supreme Court for the whole nation of Israel. They represented Israel to Rome. There were about 22 to 70 men who sat on this council. And it's so interesting that John actually gives us his name because this is a verifiable detail. This, again, is like the gospel writer saying to their readers, fact check me. You can check this out. You know there's a Sanhedrin. I'm giving you a name. His name was Nicodemus. And John tells us that he came to Jesus at night. Now, did he come to Jesus at night because he was busy during the day, or did he come to Jesus at night because he didn't want people to know that he was talking to Jesus? Now, when you read the Gospels, you're left with the impression that getting an appointment with Jesus would be a very difficult thing to do. Everywhere he went, there were crowds, and everywhere he went, there were people who were trying to get to him and get at him. So somehow, Nicodemus knew somebody, or he put his name on a waiting list, but eventually, he had an appointment with Jesus, and Jesus' only open slot was at night, or perhaps Nicodemus communicated, my only open slot is at night, because I'm not sure I want anyone to see me, an esteemed, respected person in this community, speaking to the rabbi who stirs up so much trouble. And Nicodemus showed up with a question. In fact, I bet Nicodemus showed up with a list of questions, but he never got to his questions. He came to Jesus at night and he said, Rabbi, and again, a title of respect, but there are a lot of rabbis. Rabbi, he said, we know, that is, we are certain, we know, he represents a group of people, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God. Now, this is an extraordinary thing for Nicodemus to say. It's like, you know what? You don't fit in a box. You don't fit in a category. You're not acting very Messiah-like. But there's one thing that we cannot deny. Clearly, you have come from God. And the reason we know that you've come from God is not just what you say. For no one, and we've been around for a while, no one could perform the signs. Now, this is important as well. We think of some of the things that Jesus did as miracles. But the astute, the people who were paying attention, understood that when Jesus healed people, he wasn't just doing miracles. And when people fed people, he wasn't just doing miracles. That every single one of Jesus' healings and every single one of Jesus' supernatural acts was actually a sign pointing in a direction. And Nicodemus was an educated man, and he understood these things that Jesus is doing, they're not just willy-nilly. He's not just meeting needs. There's a method to this. This is going somewhere. And it was clear to him, these signs that are pointing in a direction clearly must come from God. No one could perform the signs you were doing if God were not with him. And that was the preamble. That was the setup. That was the introduction. And then Nicodemus takes a big breath to ask his big question. And then Jesus does that Jesus thing where he answers the question before the question gets asked, just to throw the questioner off and to control the conversation. So Nicodemus rears back to ask his question. Jesus puts his hand on his shoulder, I think, and the text says, and Jesus replied, verily, verily, in some text, very truly. Remember that one? Verily, verily, King James. Verily, verily. Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they're born again. To which Nicodemus probably thought, see, there you go again. I've been watching you. This is what you do. You don't let people ask their questions, and when they ask questions, you tell them stories. Very truly, I tell you, Nicodemus, I know why you're here. I know what your question is. I know what you're getting at. You know I've come from God, but I'm not talking like other people that you would consider to be very godly. I seem to have a different angle, a different perspective. I seem to, my category seemed to be much larger than the traditional Jewish category. So let me just go to the heart of the matter. Let me just go to the bottom line for you, Nicodemus. I know we're both busy men, and you don't want to be seen with me anyway. I tell you, no one can see God. No one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born. Again, this is so confusing to Nicodemus. What do you mean I can't see the kingdom of God? I'm Jewish. And for Jewish people in the first century, the kingdom of God and the kingdom of Israel were synonymous. What do you mean I won't even see, or really, technically, you're telling me I won't even recognize the kingdom of God? Of course I will. I was born into it. And Jesus says, no, you have to be born again, or literally, to be born from above. Nicodemus, welcome to the kingdom of Israel, but to get into the kingdom of God, there's a second requirement. You have to be born again. Now, at this point, I think Nicodemus chuckles. He knows Jesus is kind of playing with him. He says, Rabbi, how can someone be born when they are old? And he points to himself. Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born. He knows that this isn't literal, but he doesn't know exactly what Jesus is saying. And then what he really wanted to say is, and Jesus, why are we talking about this? This is not what I came to talk about. And again, this is my only opportunity to be one-on-one with you. I've got questions and I've got people at home waiting for me to come back with answers to their questions. Jesus answered, very truly, I tell you, no one can enter. First, you can't see the kingdom of God. No one can enter the kingdom of God. They won't recognize it and they'll never get in unless they are born. Here it is again. Unless they are born both of water and the Spirit. Okay, Nicodemus is like, where's this going? Jesus continues, flesh gives birth to flesh. You know, Jewish people have Jewish people, right? Philistines have Philistines, Romans have Romans, Greeks have Greeks. I mean, flesh gives birth to flesh. Your flesh got you into the kingdom of Israel. Congratulations. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but Nicodemus, Spirit gives birth to Spirit. That there's something more, that it takes something else. You can be born into the kingdom of Israel, but it takes something more to be given entrance to the kingdom of God. And then I think Jesus chuckles, and he says, you, come on, Nicodemus. You of all people should not be surprised at my saying you must be born again. Come on, the wind blows wherever it pleases. Again, he goes off on another, you know, illustration. Nicodemus is going, I don't think I'm ever going to get my questions answered. The wind blows where it pleases. You hear it sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it's going. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. And there's a little word play here because Jesus uses a word in the text. The word Spirit and the word wind are the same word. He says the Spirit's like the wind. You know there's wind. You see the effects of wind. You hear the wind. You don't know where it came from. You don't know where it's going. And so it is with the Spirit of God. And what he's getting at with Nicodemus in his very first century Jewish context, which was the only context he had to draw from, he said, Nicodemus, I understand. Many, many years ago, our forefather, Abraham, God made him a promise that he would make him a family, make him a nation, and that he blessed the world through the nation. And sure enough, you and I are living in the day and age when the family became a nation and we're part of the kingdom of Israel. The God then, through Moses, made an exclusive covenant with our people. We got all those commandments, all the rules and restrictions. God made an exclusive covenant with our people. But Nicodemus, God is not exclusive. He's like the wind. He's like the Spirit. He moves outside the confines of our people's covenant with him. And yes, while we are locked into an arrangement with God, God is not limited by this arrangement. God is the mobile God. God does not live inside the temple. God is spirit. And our nation, Israel, is a means to an end. And in the end, the entire world will be given an invitation to be a part of the kingdom of God. There will be people from every tribe and every nation and every tongue. His invitation will be extended to everyone. And entrance into the kingdom of God requires a second birth, a spiritual birth. Nicodemus didn't have a category for any of this. How can this be, he asked. In other words, how did I miss this? And then again, Jesus kind of leans in. Come on, Nicodemus, you are Israel's teacher. You're one of the preeminent teachers. Everybody's looking to you for guidance. You are Israel's teacher, said Jesus, and you do not understand these things? Well, the conversation goes on and on and on. Sometimes it's clear, sometimes it's not. Nicodemus is so bewildered, but he's not resisting. He's like some of you. He doesn't get it. There's so many questions. He's not resisting. It's like, I want to understand, but I'm just not getting it. And then Jesus gets to something that's common ground between he and Nicodemus. He gets to something that Nicodemus can latch onto. He can finally get some traction. Jesus says, just as Moses. Nicodemus is like, okay, now you're talking about something I get. Moses, we know. Okay, Moses is the covenant maker and the command giver. The covenant maker, command giver. Moses came down from the mountain. He said, God's entering into a brand new kind of exclusive relationship with Israel. Here are the commandments you got to keep. It's a I will if you will kind of thing. I gotcha. Jesus says, just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness. Again, Nicodemus is like, I know this story. I've taught this story. I heard this story as a child. We thought it was so cool. The nation was moving through, going from Egypt to the promised land. They go through an area of the desert with all these snakes. People are getting snake bit. Some of the snakes are poisonous. People are sick. Some of them are dying. And then this crazy thing where Moses makes a bronze snake, like they needed another snake, and they put it on a pole, and they go through the area, and the people are saved. And yeah, I know that story. So why are we talking about that? So the Son of Man, Jesus says. So the Son of Man must be lifted up like the bronze snake on the pole. Now, once again, Nicodemus is like, wait a minute, the Son of Man, that's code for Messiah. Son of Man, that's code for the one we've been waiting for a long time. And if you put a man on a pole, clearly that man is cursed by God. Because when a man hangs from a tree or a man is impaled on a pole or a man is hoisted up on, I don't know, or say a Roman cross, when a man is on a pole or on a cross, or that's a sign of a curse. Are you telling me the Son of Man, are you telling me that the Messiah is going to suffer? That the Messiah is going to be cursed by God? Once again, I want to understand. I mean, I'm here asking questions or trying to ask my questions. I just don't understand. Jesus continues, he says, that everyone... There it is again, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. And again, Nicodemus is like, wait, life, eternal life? I mean, we know how you get eternal life. You love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. That's how you get eternal life. You keep the commandments. That's how you get eternal life. You do what God asked us to do at Mount Sinai. We know how you get eternal life. Are you telling me? Somehow, eternal life is going to be available to, let me see if I get it straight, everybody will have access to the kingdom of God. They're going to get eternal life because the Messiah is going to be put up on a pole signifying that he's cursed by God. Now, I'm going to hit pause on Nicodemus and Jesus. We're going to come back to it in just a second. I got to tell you something else. It's interesting, okay? When you're reading the Gospels, it's very, very, very important to remember, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, it's very, very important to remember that much of Jesus' teaching would not make sense until after his resurrection. So just think about it. These events actually happened in history. Matthew, you know, eyewitness, Mark, who spent time with Peter, Luke, who thoroughly investigated all these things, John, an eyewitness, they are documenting what they saw and experienced, or they're documenting what eyewitnesses saw and experienced, and they're documenting this after the story is completely over with. So every once in a while in the Gospels, the writers will pause the story will pause whatever conversation they've recorded or whatever's happening. They'll sort of pull out of the story and they'll make comments on what's happening in the narrative that they're writing about. We do this all the time when we tell stories. When you're telling a story, you're in the middle of a story, and you're kind of walking through what happened, then you kind of pull out and say, she didn't know or he didn't know. Later they would discover. Then you get right back into the story. Well, the gospel writers do this all the time. They pause the story to comment based on what they knew that the audience in the story didn't know because they hadn't gotten to the end of the story. So I'm going to give you an example of this, then we're going to go back to Nicodemus. Everybody, you following me? Everybody with me on this? Okay, good. I can just tell. Smart people. Okay, here's an illustration from Luke, Matthew, Mark, Luke. Luke is quoting Jesus. I'm going to show you the quote, and then he's going to pull out, make a comment based on what he wanted his readers to know that the people in the story at the time couldn't know. So this is just an example. Then we'll get back to Nicodemus. This is Luke, and he's quoting Jesus. Listen carefully, he writes. This is what Jesus said. Listen carefully to what I'm about to tell you, says Jesus. The Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men. So Luke says, this is what Jesus said. Then Luke hits pause on telling his audience what Jesus said, and he adds this comment. But, this is Luke's words, not Jesus, but they did not understand what this meant. Luke's writing, here's what he said, but you know what? When it happened, his audience in the story didn't know what he was talking about because they hadn't gotten to the end of the story. But I, Luke, I know how this thing's in, so I just wanted to let you know what's going to happen. Then he jumps right back into the story. We do this all the time in our storytelling. And this is important. Look up here. This is why you should take the gospel seriously, okay? This was not a motif. This was not the way that stories were written when people were writing fiction. In other words, when you read the nitty-gritty details and the in and outs of all these stories and all the names and all the details, this was not written decades and decades and decades after the fact. This was written exactly like somebody who was trying to get all the facts out, but at the same time keep the readers engaged with the story. So, in the conversation, this is so important, between Jesus and Nicodemus, John, who documents all this for us, he does that very same thing. He's telling us about the conversation between Nick and Jesus, and then he pauses the story to pull out to make sure those of us who are reading this story understand what's going on, because not only did Nicodemus not know what Jesus was getting at, John, who was there, he didn't know what Jesus was getting at either. Because Jesus was pointing to something that hadn't happened yet, that nobody had a category for. A suffering, dying, stuck on a pole, Messiah? Nobody was looking for that. Nobody was waiting for that. In fact, that's a bad ending to the wrong story. So, John pulls out temporarily to put two and two together for his readers. John, put it this way, John tells us, in his own words, these aren't Jesus, he tells us in his own words what Jesus was explaining to Nicodemus, who couldn't possibly understand what Jesus was talking about because it hadn't happened yet. But for John, what he realized later when he looked back on this conversation, he realized how important this conversation was, and he doesn't want you to miss it. He doesn't want his reader to miss it. And the reader would eventually get to the end of the story. In fact, many of the readers of the Gospel of John had heard the story. They just never heard it read. But John didn't want to wait. And this is the coolest thing about it to me. Little did he know. I mean, he has no idea. Little did John know that he would dictate, because I don't think he wrote this. I think he dictated this to a scribe. Little did he know that he would dictate 26 words that would reverberate around the world, generation after generation after generation after generation, 26 words that would survive the empire and survive the temple way beyond his generation. 26 words that would change the world that his friend had come to save. So he pauses from the conversation between Jesus and Nicodemus. And it's like he's saying to you, and it's like he's saying to me, you see, I want you to understand this, you see. For God so loved the world. Nicodemus said he can't get outside of his Jewish framework. Of course he couldn't. And it's like John says, I don't want to wait till the end of the story. I want you to understand what he was trying to say to Nicodemus. It's so important. For God so loved the cosmos, the whole world, that he gave. He hasn't given it yet. This is why Nicodemus can't figure it out. Nobody can figure out how is a Messiah going to suffer and die. That he gave his one and only son. And then he struggles and tries to figure out exactly how do I say this, and they use a little Greek word that's a conjunction, that's a connector word, a henna clause, we call it in Greek. He says, in order that, henna, in order that. And then John does something extraordinary. In fact, in all of Greek literature, no one took the Greek word, the Greek noun for believe or the Greek verb for believe and connected to this preposition. It's like John is saying, okay, I got to get this right. It's not whoever believes that. It's not whoever believes that. This isn't about believing facts. It's whoever, and there's no Greek word for trust. There's no Greek word for trust. It's just believe. So John, even, and perhaps he's dictating this to a scribe, and the scribe's like, okay, you can't say it that way. And John's like, no, I want you to say it this way. It's not good grammar. We know it's not good grammar because this phrase doesn't show up anywhere until it shows up in John's gospel. John says, do it this way anyway. That whoever believes in, as in trust in, will not perish, will not be, this word is used throughout the gospel of John, will not be lost. Will not be lost to God. And then the strongest contrast in Greek, but will have eternal life. Write it that way. Now, he had no idea. Now, this is very important, especially if you've left church, you're not a Christian, or the Bible's full, you know, mistakes. You just listen a second. Okay, look up here. In this moment, John is not writing the Bible. The Bible, to Biblia, that doesn't show up till the 4th century when all of these documents got collected and then got put together with the Old Testament scriptures and got, you know, put a big old gold, you know, folder around it and a gold cover on it, the to Biblia. John's not writing the Bible. In fact, this has nothing to do with the Bible. This is a man who saw things that would blow our little itty-bitty minds. And at the end of the story, knows he's got to document it because he's one of the few people who was there for all of it. And he dictates it to a scribe, and he doesn't want it in Aramaic, and he doesn't want it in Hebrew. He wants it in Greek. And do you know why he wants it in Greek? Because Greek was the language of the empire. It wasn't the language of Palestine. It was the language of the empire. And John seemed to know more than anybody else. This is a message for the whole world. So let's get it in a language the whole world can understand and embrace. For God so loved the world, he gave it. And then John says, okay, before I get back to the story, there's one more thing I got to say. Because they're going to miss this. I don't want to wait till the end of the story. In fact, they may get to the end of the story and miss this. So I want to make sure they got this. Because this is what Jesus was trying to communicate to Nicodemus. Nicodemus, whose whole worldview was, when Messiah comes, we're going to throw the invaders out. So John adds, these are his words, for God, just so he didn't want us to miss it, for God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world. God didn't send Messiah into the world to judge the world. God didn't send his son into the world to line up all the sinners and tell them about all of their sin. He didn't come to the scene of an accident and lecture those who had been injured. I have. The church has. Jesus didn't. I've not come. Jesus didn't come, John says, to condemn the world, but that the world, through him, might be saved. He showed up like an EMT. And he just went to work. And when he realized that the world needed a blood transfusion, he used his own. And suddenly we're thrown back to day one. John the Baptist, banks of the Jordan River. Everybody's waiting because John says, it's going to happen, it's going to happen, it's about to happen, it's about to happen. And John says, everybody who's been looking at me, look. I want you to look there from now on, look. The Lamb of God who comes to take away the sin of the world. And John is writing this. It's like, oh, we should have seen it. We should have put two and two together. But I want to make sure my readers get it before they get to the end of the story. For God, not just Jesus, for God so loved the world that he gave. See, when you love, this is what you do, isn't it? When you love, you give. When you love, you give. That's what you do when you love. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and his only son, that whoever, and here it is, whoever not just believes that. See, you don't become a Christian because of faith. You become a Christian because all of the evidence points to the fact that Jesus is who Jesus claims to be. That's why you become a Christian. You don't become a Christian because of faith. You come become a Christian by faith because placing your trust in Jesus, that transaction is how you get connected to the kingdom of God. That whoever believes in him won't be lost to God, won't perish, won't fall away, won't get lost in the shuffle, but have a different kind of life, eternal life. That you will be born, as Jesus was trying to explain to Nicodemus, you will be born again into a brand new family, a family where you have the privilege to call God your Father. Years later, another Pharisee, a Pharisee who claimed to be the best Pharisee of all, who tried to put the church out of business, who then became a Jesus follower. He looks back after the resurrection at the whole story and he says, this is how I see it. It's as if God is inviting you to participate in an adoption process, but you're not the one doing the adoption. You're the one being adopted. And you get to choose whether or not you want to be adopted. And if you say yes, God is more than happy to adopt you into his family, because of what Christ has done on the front end to make that possible. Now, when we explain John 3:16 to children, here's how we explain it to children at all of our churches, at all of our campuses, it's everywhere that we have an opportunity. Here's how we explain it to children. We put it this way. That God loved, so he gave. That's what you do when you love. God loved, God gave, and what are we supposed to do? We're supposed to believe, not believe that, trust in. We believe, and then we receive. Eternal life. God loved, God gave. We believe, we receive. God loved, God gave. Starts with God. We believe, we receive. That getting into the kingdom of God is not about D-O. It's about D-O-N-E. He did all the heavy lifting. And he says, it's an invitation that I'm inviting you to accept. Now back to Nick and Jesus for just a minute. We don't know exactly what Nick made of this conversation. He kind of wanders off and he gets home and his wife and you know, everybody's like, how did it go? You know, did you get my question answered? Nick's like, no. Something about the Messiah is going to die on a pole and everybody gets in. I don't know. I don't have any idea what he's talking about. But eventually Nick got it. And here's how we know. Because after Jesus was crucified, Nick's in the back of the crowd, no doubt. He's a Sanhedrin. He's kind of responsible for this whole thing, you know, around Passover. He's in the back of the crowd. Can you imagine this moment? All he sees are the tops of heads. He knows Jesus has been arrested. He's absolutely sure Jesus has come from God. This was not the ending he expected. And he's looking over a whole bunch of tops of heads, you know. And suddenly, can you imagine this moment? And suddenly, lifted up from in front of the crowd, he sees the cross. And there hangs Jesus. And it's like, it's as he said. Cursed by God. Abandoned by his own people. Not the end of the story any of us anticipated. But exactly what he predicted. And when Jesus is dead, Nicodemus risks his reputation once again. And I think risks his life. And he and a guy named Joseph from Arimathea. Again, John gives us all these details. It's like, okay, you don't think this story is true? Fact check me. These are the names. Ask them. Find these people. They're still running around. Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus. They're absolutely sure this man came from God. This is not the end of the story the way we anticipated the end of the story, but this man deserves more than to have his body dumped on a pile of other bodies for the dogs to come and eat. So they go to Pilate, and they probably have to slip Pilate a few coins to say, we would like to have that body because it's against the law to bury the body of someone who's crucified. And Pilate gives them permission to take the body, and the sun's going down, and Sabbath is about to begin, and they take about 100 plus pounds, which means they had two or three servants with them, and they get to this tomb that had never been used before, and Joseph of Arimathea's wife's like, now, honey, wait, are you sure you want to use our tomb? I mean, you know how much that thing costs? It's all cleaned out. It's for our family, and, you know, Joseph, you're going to be, are you sure? And he's like, yes. I don't know exactly who this guy was. But he deserves better than this. And we're going to use our tomb. And they prepare the body the best they can because they're in a hurry, and they put him in, close that stone over the front to seal it so animals won't get in. so that eventually that body will deteriorate to, well, there's nothing left but bones, and they would go back in later, take the bones, put it in an ossuary, and give it to a family member or bury it somewhere. And Nicodemus participated in that. He did not have answers to all of his questions, but he knew enough to know that this man had come from God. And maybe that's you. You'll always have questions, and I'll never have all the answers for you. But if you know that you know, if there's something that when you hear this story, it stirs your heart, and maybe it's been stirring your heart for weeks or months or years, and you've heard it and you've heard it and you come and you go, and it's like, but today, maybe for the first time, the dots connected. It's like that, you know, you sort of got that last bit of information or that thing that kind of pushed you over the line. And if today that you're like Nicodemus, I know enough to know that Jesus came from God, then I want to invite you to do what John, who was an eyewitness to the entire story, suggested that we all do. Everyone in the whole world do. This was the point of his gospel. This was the point of Jesus coming. I think he would say to you, would you do what I've suggested? Because eventually Nicodemus did, Joseph of Arimathea did, millions and millions and millions of people since then did. Would you be willing to believe and receive? The invitation is open because God already loved and God already gave. What Nicodemus couldn't put together because it hadn't happened yet is so clear to us because we're on the other side. So I want to invite you to consider, would you today, would you do what Nicodemus ultimately did, what John encouraged us to do, what Jesus came so that we'd have the privilege to do? Would you believe? Would you trust him? And would you receive Jesus as your Savior?